welcome everyone. Just on a somber note, let me just start by expressing our concern and sympathies for the people of Houston and Texas. They're our neighbors in the Southwest, and they're going through hell at the moment, and so we are thinking of them, and I hope that support and some measure of relief comes swiftly. Okay, so, all right, yes. So let me thank, as we always do, the marvelous Lensic, our partners in these events. Absolutely. Yes. And Thornburg Investment Management for sponsoring this extraordinary series. So I want to remind you, there was a notice for an upcoming lecture, an economics panel on September the 12th. It will improve your ideas, it will improve your bank account, but not as much as this evening's talk will improve your lives. So it's just a pleasure for me to be introducing Geoffrey West, who's a good friend and a colleague at SFI, and I want to tell you a little bit about his life story and embarrass him ever so slightly. So Geoffrey was born in Taunton in Somerset. In England we call that Somerset. It's where they make very strong cider, scrumpy cider. You might know about it because Thomas Hardy set some of his stories in Toneborough, with his name for Taunton, in the fictional county of Wessex, including his great novel Jude the Obscure, which is one of Geoffrey's favorite novels, and perhaps a clue to his character. Geoffrey moved to London when he was 13 years old, and he went to school with one of Britain's most notorious criminals, the armed robber John McVicar, who was described by Scotland Yard as public enemy number one. Geoffrey survived high school and John McVicar, and he went to Cambridge, where he studied physics at Gonville and Caius College. Now, Gonville and Caius is the same college that, in an earlier generation, the quantum physicist Max Born had studied at. Joseph Needham, the great chemist, developmental biologist, and historian of science, and of course William Harvey, in the 17th century, who was the pioneer on the circulation of the blood. And I mention them because if you can join them, the interests of these scholars, there's a clue to Geoffrey's work. From Born, the rigors of theoretical physics, from Needham, an interest in science and in society, and from Harvey, the principles of circulation. And of course, you throw in a little bit of John McVicar for spice. Now, these ideas didn't immediately conjoin. You'd have to wait several decades, and he took a detour through high-energy physics. He did his PhD at Stanford. He then had postdocs at Cornell and Harvard. He came back to Stanford to join the faculty, and eventually came to New Mexico, where he essentially headed up the high-energy physics group at Los Alamos National Laboratory. He became involved with the Santa Fe Institute in the 1990s and joined the faculty full-time in 2003, and then was a predecessor of mine, was president of SFI from 2005 to 2009, and a real inspiration in that role for all of us. I just want to return to this convergence in his trajectory. Where did his odd ideas come from? If you go back to 1989, when he was working in high-energy physics, he gave three talks in that year. He gave many more, I imagine. But here are three of them. Light Higgs, Dark Matter, and the Solar Neutrino Problem. That was one. Here's another. Can we make sense of QCD perturbation theory? QCD is quantum chromodynamics. And here's the third and the most interesting. Scaling in various physical systems ranging from animals to quarks. And the final talk, of course, is the first clue to the forthcoming metamorphosis into complexity scientist. In 1993, he and his collaborators began pursuing scaling theory in earnest, and I think that's when the ghosts of Max Born and William Harvey finally met and mated in Geoffrey's mind. And Geoffrey Needham had to wait another decade before he became excited about cities for the whole issue of science and society to take root. And this is all work that Geoffrey will discuss this evening, and that's been beautifully summarized in this absolutely wonderful book, that I'm sure many of you have read, many of you are reading, and if not, you should read. It really is very good and very inspirational. I should just add that in 2006, Jeff was included in the Time 100 annual list of the 100 most influential people in the world, according to Time magazine, and according to the Santa Fe Institute as well. Let me just end by just pointing out that we're living at a time when science is simultaneously venerated and deprecated. Big data, computational power, advances in mathematics and statistics are changing the way we look at the world and the way we interact with the world. When you combine these with the facts of population growth, ecological transformation, conflict, and climate change, there's never been a time when deep, new ideas are as important and practical as they are today. The Santa Fe Institute considers it an obligation to work on the very hardest problems with great energy, rigor, and honesty. I consider Geoffrey an exemplary citizen at SFI and a world leader in these pursuits. Geoffrey.
Well, thank you, David, for that embarrassingly hyperbolic and also slightly eccentric introduction. And it's true what he said about Johnny McVicar. He sat next to me, I sat next to him for 2 years, and indeed he did become the most wanted criminal in the United Kingdom. But when he got out of prison eventually on good behavior, he had studied meanwhile criminology and became the criminology correspondent for the London Observer newspaper. So tonight I've chosen a really challenging title, and it obviously covers, and the subtitle covers an extraordinary broad set of ideas and subjects and challenges and so on. And what I'm going to try to do is present a somewhat different way of looking at the question of global sustainability and some of the questions that are implicit in that idea or that question. And I'm coming to it as a physicist, shamelessly as a physicist, which means I'm asking the question and searching for the possibility of getting a analytic, quantitative, predictive theory underlying what the future of the planet might be in its grandest terms. And you'll see there's lots of loose ends, many, many loose ends, both because we only have a short time and largely because this is an enormous subject and much of the work that I'm going to discuss is in fact only just scratching the surface. But it's what I do want to present is really a way of thinking. Now, you heard from David that I spent most of my career thinking about quarks and gluons and dark matter and string theory, and then I ventured into various questions in biology, which I will actually touch on in a little bit. And so this whole question of the future of the planet is inspired, in fact, by asking the question, what can we learn from biology and physics? So before getting into that, I sort of want to set the scene so that we're all sort of on the same page. And I'm going to do it by reminding us, first of all, something everybody knows, is, I wouldn't say exactly familiar with, but is cognizant of, and that is that we live in an exponentially expanding universe. The universe we live in is continually expanding, and everything is moving away from everything else, so to speak. But what we don't appreciate, or at least we don't articulate, even though we viscerally are all cognizant of it, is the fact that we live in an exponentially expanding socioeconomic universe. In fact, every metric to do with our socioeconomic lives is increasing exponentially and has been doing so certainly for the last couple of hundred years. And just to give you a sense of the scale of that, I put some numbers up here because I'm going to talk quite a bit about cities near the end. And this is just in terms of cities and urbanization. Just to remind you that 200 years ago, when the United States was formed, we were overwhelmingly agricultural and rural. Only a few percent of the population lived in what could be called cities. Now that is completely reversed, or essentially completely reversed, that the overwhelming majority of people, something almost close to 85%, now live in urban areas. And just a few years ago, the world crossed this extraordinary halfway mark of becoming the majority of us living in urban areas. And indeed, somewhere towards the second half of this century, the planet will in fact reach this some sort of 70-80% level of being urbanized. So just to give you again a sense of what that means, if you just take those numbers and you average from now to mid-century, that is equivalent to urbanizing at the rate of actually closer to 1.5 million people every week. I just learned yesterday morning, by the way, from the World Economic Forum, the people who run Davos, that actually at this present time, we're urbanizing at the rate of twice this, 3 million people a week. So you can double the numbers I'm going to tell you now. So this is equivalent to adding a New York metropolitan area, the entire New York metropolitan area, every couple of months, which means that, where are we? The end of August, the end of October, there's going to be the equivalent to another New York metropolitan area on the planet, and by Christmas, another New York metropolitan area, and so on every 2 months, inextricably, so to speak, well into mid-century and possibly beyond. And that's also another way of looking at it, is that that's equivalent to adding a city of San Francisco every 4 to 6 days, or, since we're here, adding a Santa Fe every 12 hours. When you wake up tomorrow morning, there will be the equivalent to a Santa Fe on this planet. So that's pretty amazing. And it gets reflected in things like this. China, which was very slow to urbanize, has been catching up at an extraordinary rate. It only crossed the halfway mark a year or so ago, in the last couple of years, but is on the fast track to catch up, and has to catch up in a certain sense, and because of that is claims to be building and is building of the order of 200 to 300 new cities, each in excess of 1 million people in the next 15 to 20 years. And that's just China. We have India, we have Africa, we have Latin America, and so on. And so we have this extraordinary phenomenon that's taking place over a very short period of time. And the stress on energy, on resources, on water, on cement, on copper, on rubidium, whatever, you name it, is extraordinary. And maybe the biggest stress will be on the social fabric. And what this phenomenon is clearly going to affect everybody on the planet, and there's no hiding from it, whether you live in New York City or in Santa Fe. So here's a picture many of you are familiar with, the whole Earth, so to speak. This is the famous picture of the planet nightlights. This is the NASA satellites taking a picture at night of the Earth. And you see the obvious, that it glows. There it is, glowing. If you took this picture, if we'd been able to take this picture when I was a boy, you would just see a faint, it would be like toning down the lights, like at the back of this auditorium, as distinct from on me. And so this is extraordinary. This has happened in just a short period of my lifetime. And you can see the Earth is sort of alive. It's this virus has taken over, and it's glowing. And it's burning. That's why the atmosphere, of course, is getting warm. And that's why we're having many of the problems we have, and I want to expand a little bit on that. So all of this, of course, is related and derivative, and to some extent, from the extraordinary population growth that we've experienced since we emerged from being hunter-gatherers, became sedentary creatures, formed societies, formed communities, and ultimately formed cities, the kinds of cities we all live in. And that began 10 to 12,000 years ago, and you can see the beginning, roughly speaking, with the Industrial Revolution, the population has just completely shot up at this extraordinary rate, and it's destined to reach maybe of the order of 10 billion, maybe 12 billion by the end of the century. So this is an extraordinary phenomenon, and it's also interrelated with the extraordinary discovery that we made beginning with the Industrial Revolution, not just that we discovered technology from coal and steam, but we also, around that time, of course, discovered, invented free market systems, capitalism, entrepreneurship, and so on. And it is the fruits of those, with the technological revolutions that came along with them, that has led us pretty much to this stage and to the kinds of the quality and standard of living many of us are privileged to enjoy. So that's quite phenomenal, and it's been unbelievably successful. And I will later come back to this and examine whether this is at all sustainable. That's really the big question. So there it is. That's just the idea, this paradigm that we have, and we need to maintain this kind of open-ended growth. So I see the focus of this and the manifestation of it in our built environment, cities. And I will come back and talk a great deal about that later. But the point I want to first make is that the fate of our planet into its future is really bound up with the fate of our cities, what happens in our cities, what has happened, and what will happen, because all of the tsunami of problems that we face, from climate change to questions of markets, to questions of disease, to questions of resources, and so on and so forth, all of these big questions that are challenging us are all generated by urbanization, because that's where the people are. And so this, and I will again come back to elaborate on this, so it is inherent upon us to try to understand what this phenomenon is. How did it happen? How is it happening? And where is it going? So let's talk a teeny bit first about cities. We all know what they look like. This is the system. And the question is, can we make a science of this system? Can we understand, as we do other physical phenomena, what is going on here, and why it's led to this, and why it keeps going, and what its future will be? Well, first of all, we all understand the attraction of cities. They provide greater opportunities, more job opportunities, a sense of greater material wealth and well-being, access to many different things, access to a sort of a jazzier, sexier life, culture, events like this, for example, fancy restaurants, good education, and so on. All of this is inherent in the attractive aspects of cities, and all of this has been part of their enormous success, and as I say, of their extraordinary continuing attraction. Now, cities classically have been dealt with by social scientists and economists very much in either a geographic or in an economic context. So what I'm going to try to do is change that a little bit and talk about it in a physics context, because one of the things that we know in physics is that none of this could be supported, no matter how many ideas and marvelous things we do together, none of it can be supported without a supply of energy and the transformation of energy. So this is crucial. This plays a crucial underlying role. And one of the things that we also learned from physics, and in fact, perhaps the most fundamental law of physics, is the second law of thermodynamics, which I'm sure most of you have at least heard of. But let me just tell you what it says in simple English. It says that if you use energy to create or maintain order in a system, that means, for example, creating a cell, creating an organism, creating a car, creating a city, whatever the artifact is, by creating order, somewhere you create disorder, inevitably. So that means in bringing this energy and using it to transform raw energy into us and being here and all the marvelous things that we do, there's a price to pay, and that is called entropy. And I want to just change that slightly and talk about socioeconomic entropy. And this is the kind of thing I'm thinking of. This is the price we pay for bringing great order to the world we live in, these kinds of things. This is entropy, this kind of stuff, disease, and indeed, social unrest. And I would venture, speculate, that much of social unrest, which may be in the name of ethnic violence, it may be in the name of religion, it may be in the name of culture, whatever, has its actually deeper origins in this phenomenon of the stresses and strains caused by this extraordinary expansion. And one of the big questions is this what our cities will look like? Is that what New York and San Francisco are going to look like in 50 years, which many cities across the globe now do? Or is that what London's going to look like in 50 years? And just going from what David said, sadly, our fourth largest city looks like this as we speak. And whether that's to do with this phenomenon, yet to be discussed, and I'm happy to discuss it at the end of the lecture, actually. So, you know, when we think of cities, we usually, in our imagery, we think of the physicality of the cities. We think of the boulevards of Paris, the skyscrapers of New York, the adobe of Santa Fe, whatever. But we usually think of it in terms of its physical manifestation. But of course, the city is much more than that. And in fact, what I'm going to try to stress is that, in fact, in some ways, that's the least interesting part of the city. And the more interesting part is illustrated by things like this. That is the fact that cities, I know this sounds like a kind of platitude or a no-brainer, cities are actually for people. That's what cities are for. Cities are a machine to bring people together and facilitate social interaction. We've invented maybe our greatest invention in terms of facilitating facilitating interaction so as to produce ideas, innovate, create wealth and well-being. So this maybe is even more of what a city really is this, bringing people together in various forms to sit around, talk, interact, bullshit, whatever, creating ideas. Many of the ideas being discussed here are no doubt trivial, but they're ideas. But occasionally, a profound idea emerges. So that's what a city is for. Secondly, notice the stage upon which this interaction is taking place has been there for maybe over 2,000 years. The same thing, in essence, in spirit at least, has been going on for 2,000 years. The city persists, people change, ideas grow, ideas build on new ideas, and so on and so forth. And another version of that is closer to home, is this picture from about 120 years ago of New York City's. And you can, again, viscerally feel the primitive form of entrepreneurship, of the desire to move on, ideas being created, and so on. And once again, that street exists still in New York. Those people don't. It doesn't look like that anymore. But the spirit of New York persists in all those big buildings elsewhere and so on, trying to create what you feel is going on here and is the origin of our ideas, our innovation, and indeed our wealth. So, that being said, the very essence of a city can be thought of in two different pieces, and in fact, I would say, of any complex adaptive system, has two components. One is its physicality, its infrastructure, associated with it, its use of energy and resources, and metabolism, in biological terms. That, on the one hand, and on the other, the exchange of information, which is what those pictures were all about, were people exchanging information, and that is to do with maybe the analog in biology, genomics, or the neural system, and so on. But the exchange of interaction, the exchange of information via interaction, leading, as I put there, to innovation and wealth and so forth. So having said that, we sort of see that since cities have been growing at this extraordinary rate, and that essentially all the problems that we face are generated by cities, we, as I emphasized earlier, we need to focus and understand cities, but even more so because we realize that they're not only the problem, they are the solution. Because, just because of what I said, that's where the people are. Cities are magnets or vacuum cleaners that suck up smart, intelligent people, the entrepreneurs, the people that want to create. And that is why almost all the ideas, all the interesting ideas that have evolved, primarily come from urban environments. Again, because the city as a machine for facilitating interaction, an extraordinary invention. So, given the problems we have to face, the question we have to ask is, can we develop, is it even conceivable that we can develop a serious science of cities in the sense that we think of in terms of physics and chemistry and so forth? Now, cities are an unbelievably complex system, and they're extraordinarily diverse, and as I've already indicated, all of the problems we face are generated in cities. And here's just the beginning of a kind of laundry list of many of the problems that we could associate with cities and society in general. And you notice I put them in boxes, because the way we study them and the way we deal with them is we do them in boxes. Each one of these is dealt with in its own discipline, it's funded in its own place, whether from the federal government or from foundations, and so on and so forth. And indeed, I could have, or maybe I should have, taken each one of these boxes and inside that boxed each one of those other things. Because, for example, people study population, but they often don't discuss health with it, and so on. So all of these are dealt with in a stovepipe way. And one of the things that one learns when one studies complex adaptive systems is that all of these things are, and you know it, not independent of each other. First of all, each one of them is complex and adapting and evolving, but they are all interacting with each other. And one of the other things one learns about dealing with complex adaptive systems is that if you ignore the multiple interactions, you're destined to unintended consequences in terms of predictions and understanding. So we have to start thinking in much bigger terms and thinking in much more systemic terms, to which I will return shortly. But I first want to take a short digression into what we learn from biology, because biology, of course, has much in common with what I just said. And furthermore, it's an illustration of something that I need to explain a little bit, and that is what I said at the beginning. I'm a physicist. What I mean by doing science is quantitative, based on principles, mathematizable, computable, and ultimately predictive and tested by experiment and observation. Well, physics has been unbelievably successful. I mean, for example, there was this marvelous eclipse a week ago. Marvelous, fantastic, a spiritual experience. The moon got between us and our mother, the sun. Frightening and extraordinary. But you know, from a science viewpoint, it's obviously trivial. It's just a bloody shadow of the moon that came across the earth. Nothing very... What was truly exciting about that, truly amazing, and of biblical proportions, is that we could predict exactly when that eclipse was taking place, how long it would last, no matter where you were. We can predict the next one and the one after, how big it is, how much of the sun is going to be unobservable, and so on. That is an amazing, amazing achievement, a great achievement, following just from Newton's laws, basically. It's extraordinary. So the question is it conceivable that we could have such a framework for discussing the kinds of things I've just talked about, cities and socioeconomic characteristics and so forth? Well, almost certainly the answer is no. We can't be precise about those things. And indeed, many of these fields have not been very open to trying to make analytic conceptual frameworks for these kinds of systems. However, it is conceivable, maybe, that whereas we can't make, so to speak, infinitely accurate predictions, maybe we can make what physicists call coarse-grained descriptions, kind of average descriptions. So let me give you an example of it. So I can make a prediction, a biological prediction, with, I would say, almost 100% certainty about everybody in this room. All of you will be dead in 100 years. It's a quantitative prediction, and I'm sure, that it's true. Some of us, sadly, and many of us, actually, when I looked around the audience, are going to be... well... So, that's a coarse-grained question. Where does that 100 years come from? And the answer to it, maybe, is a coarse-grained answer, that maybe we can understand the dynamics, the mechanism, whatever it is, that leads to our lifespan, not just that we age, but why we die, but why is it 100 years? Why isn't it 1,000 years, or 1,000,000 years, or 5 years? What is it? Could be 2 or 3 years, like a mouse. A mouse is made of the same stuff as us, but it only lives a couple of years. So where does this number come from? So that's a coarse-grained question, and the answer to it would be a coarse-grained answer, and that's what I've written down here. And indeed, you know, an answer would, of course, relate it to some, maybe to structure of molecules that make up our respiratory complex, where we make our energy and our genes and so on. So the fundamental question is in this, and I'm not going to, unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about it, but you can read about it in the book, actually. What in the hell happened here? So, now, I'll probably get sued for that. So, I can make another prediction about everybody in this room, which is maybe not quite as precise, and that is all of you, a post-diction and a prediction, all of you slept of the order of 7-8 hours last night, and tonight you're going to also sleep of the order of 7-8 hours. Now, why is that? Why did you need to sleep, and why did you need to sleep for just 7 or 8 hours and not 16 hours like a mouse, or 4 hours like an elephant, or 2 hours like a whale? Where do those numbers come from, and why? So that's a coarse-grained question and coarse-grained answers to those, and I don't have time to go into them, but I will set up the framework for discussing it, because I want to talk about sustainability. So that's what I said there, sorry. So here's some coarse-grained questions about socioeconomic quantities. So first of all, we could ask, to what extent are cities and companies just very large organisms? To what extent is New York a great big whale, or Microsoft an elephant? I mean, they have much in common, and indeed, if you read the literature on cities, and you read the literature, all those books telling you how to make a fortune or how to run a company, many of them use biological metaphors continuously. They talk about the DNA of the company, the metabolism of the city, the ecology of the marketplace, and all these other terms, and the question is, do they have substance? So one of the questions that I've written up there is one that is quite intriguing, I think, and that is, why is it that whereas we all are destined to die, and indeed all companies are destined to die, why is it that cities don't seem to be? I mean, you can, of course, tell me cities that have disappeared, but, you know, in modern times especially, it's very hard to kill a city. We've done a terrible thing, in a way. We did this experiment of dropping atom bombs on 2 cities, and, you know, within a relatively short period, maybe 30 years, maybe less, they were fine. So it's there. So cities are incredibly resilient, and companies are extraordinarily fragile. A little fluctuation in the stock market, big companies, many die, and do die. And I will, if I have time at the end, I would like to come back to that. Okay. So, there you are. So, let's talk about us. This is us. We're a mammal. We're one of these, a shrew. That's us, the smallest version of us, a shrew on the palm of my hand. We come in very different sizes, different, we look different. There's an elephant, and that little, you can't see it there. It's very bad, the projection here. But where that arrow goes is sort of the mouse on the scale of an elephant. And this is an elephant, this is the whale. It's not quite to see, the elephant should probably be a little bit bigger on this, but that's the elephant on the scale of a whale. We're extraordinary, we cover 100 million times in magnitude of our mass, we do. And not only that, we're the biggest organism that's ever existed on this planet. We are truly extraordinary. But we've all evolved by natural selection, of course. And each one of us, meaning each one of these species, has evolved in its own unique evolutionary history, for its own unique environmental niche, and adapted accordingly. Each subsystem of it, each genome, each cell type has. So, you know, that's sort of the extraordinary diversity and the extraordinary challenge of biology. And with that thinking, one would naively think that if you measured any characteristic of these, of this set of animals, and you plotted that characteristic versus their size, the points would lie sort of random, not maybe not randomly, but would be much distributed across the graph, the points reflecting, that distribution reflecting their historical evolutionary path. Well, quite the contrary, it turns out. So this is maybe the most fundamental quantity, certainly from a physicist's viewpoint, about life. That is its metabolic rate. How much energy does it need per second to stay alive? How much food does it need to eat in order to stay alive? And this is plotted on the vertical axis and against the mass on the horizontal axis. And you notice that it's plotted what we call logarithmically, which just simply means it goes up by factors of 10, 1, 10, 100, 1,000, on both axes, because, first of all, if you try to plot the mouse and the elephant in a linear plot, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 grams, all the way up to, well, this is 10,000 grams, and up to a whale, if you try to put it on the, I don't know where, the elephant would probably sit in, I don't know, Española or somewhere. So this sort of contracts it all down, and you can put the mouse and the elephant on the same graph. And what you see is something extraordinary, something incredibly simple about a phenomenon that is possibly the most complex phenomenon in the universe, metabolism, keeping life going, making life, essentially. And the other thing about this graph that's interesting is that the slope of it is less than one. Now, let me explain what that means. If it were one, that would mean it's linear, which simply means if I double the size, in which case you would expect to double the number of cells, you'd expect to double the amount of energy needed to stay alive. Quite the contrary again. No, what this says, if you double the size, you don't need twice as much, you only need 75%. So roughly speaking, every time you double the size, 2 grams to 4 grams, 20 kilograms to 40 kilograms, whatever, you only need 75% as much energy, you save 25% on this continuous basis. So that is called an economy of scale, and the fact that the slope of this is less than one is called sublinear. So this is, you know, an amazing graph in many ways, and what is also amazing is if I plotted such a graph for any taxonomic group, fish, birds, crustacea, plants, trees, whatever, it would look just like this, and indeed with the same three-quarters slope, with the same 25% savings. So that's what I said here. But what is even more surprising is if I measure any quantity, if I plot any quantity, physiological quantity or life history event that can be measured about these organisms, it has a similar characteristic. So here's just two or three mundane ones. Well, the first one's mundane. It's heart rate versus size, and there it's plotted in the same way, going up by factors of 10. And you see again a nice straight line. This time it's going down, which simply says that the bigger you are, the slower the heart rate. That's what I've written at the top, basically. And the slope of that is minus 1/4. Minus means it's going down, but the 1/4 occur again. And here's something much more profound. Is you, your brain, the white and gray matter of the brain. You remember the gray is the processing part, the gray is the kind of cabling. And here it is, and you see again, amazing simplicity underlying the extraordinary complexity, and the slope of that is very close to 5/4. And here's another one, again, that is at the other end of the spectrum, genome length versus size for a bunch of cells. And there's much more scatter here. Most of the plots actually look like the ones I've shown, but some have much more scatter. But the important point is the best fit for this has a slope, which I've written down there, very close to 1/4. And I could show you 50 or more of such graphs of anything you could think of that could be measured. And they all look just like this, and they all have the following characteristic, that their slopes are typically multiples, simple multiples of 1/4, like the ones I've shown you. Therefore, the number 4 is sort of this magic number of life from this viewpoint. It's some special number that controls much of the structure of and life history of what goes on around us. And here's one. I'm going to hark back to my morbid interest in mortality and show you how lifespan varies. This is the only, it's not really an equation. There are no equations. There's tons of mathematics and technicalities under this, and I'm just washing all over that and not showing, obviously, any equations. Here there is sort of an equation. I just did it because I thought there should be. But there's this just simply says lifespan scales with mass in the way I just showed, but the slope is 1/4 again, so lifespan. The reason I'm showing you this is because we just saw here, if I can go back, that heart rate decreases with a slope of minus 1/4. Lifespan increases with 1/4. Lifespan decreases 1/4. If you multiply them together, the increase of one cancels the decrease of the other. So lifespan times heart rate is the same for all mammals. Same for the little shrew here and the big whale. And what is lifespan times heart rate? It's the number of heartbeats in a lifetime. And that number is approximately, which I've written there, 1.5 billion. And here's the data, and you can see. And there's something fantastic about that. I mean, the idea that this little shrew is living for a year or two, and the clock inside it is going very, very fast. I think its heart beats over 1,000 times a minute. Very, very fast. But maybe in some weird way it experiences life just like we do, as if it's 100 years. Who in the hell knows? But interesting, interesting to speculate about. So there are all these amazing scaling laws, all dominated by this 1/4, so that if you take that little mouse and you apply these scaling laws to it, and you scale everything about it up, it ends up being the elephant. We're all scaled versions of one another. And indeed, if you ask the question, why aren't there little elephants? You don't know how to answer it. You say, there are little elephants. We call them mice. That's the point. So, the question is, of course, from a science viewpoint, where in the hell do all these things come from? Where do these extraordinary regularities come from? And I'm not going to spend time on that. I'm just going to tell you. It comes from something that is, you have to ask, what it obviously has to be, if it's true across all different kinds of taxonomic groups that I mentioned, it must be something that transcends their evolved design. We are quite different than a tree, and yet they satisfy pretty much the same scaling laws that we do. Why is that? Well, the idea is that it all resides in the physics and mathematics and generic universal properties and principles of networks and network design. And I'm going to have to say that, and there's a whole bunch of mathematics and so on, and if you do that, and it takes a long time, you turn the crank and do all the mathematics, put all these statements into mathematics, then out pop all those scaling laws. So here I just show you a picture of networks. That's you in the middle. Actually, most of these are you in some form. That's your brain on the left, the white to gray matter. On the bottom right is networks within cells, and on the top right are networks within mitochondria, and so on. So it's, one can understand these scaling laws, and now you have a well-defined generic theory for calculating many things. You can understand much about these networks. David mentioned William Harvey, who was the first to lead us to an understanding of our circulatory system. Well, this allows you to calculate everything you want about the circulatory system, not only its structure, about every vessel, on the average, in this coarse-grained way, I need to emphasize, but the circulatory system of any organism that has a beating heart, and not only that, but in terms of all the blood flow and so on and so forth. Well, that is very powerful because it allows you to then address a whole bunch of questions, including the ones I discussed earlier, aging, mortality, and sleep. But the one I'm going to focus on, because it's a segue into social phenomena, is growth. So we're all familiar with growth. We've all gone through it, and we've all scaled accordingly. We've all scaled up accordingly in a highly nonlinear way. And we all know how we did it. In some, I mean, we know because we did it. That is, we ate, we metabolized that food, and we sent that food through networks to sustain cells, to maintain them, to repair damage, to replace those that have died, and to create new ones. Okay, there's a picture there, so to speak. There it is. That's the sort of energy cycle, so to speak, of a human being. And what I just said is on the right there. The incoming metabolized energy then is therefore allocated between maintenance on the one hand and new growth on the other. And that has to also be put into mathematics. The arrow, that's sort of an equal sign, but it's actually the network. The network is the thing that distributes it to the cells in order for them to be maintained and to grow new ones. So if you put that into mathematics and you solve the equations and all the rest of it, you can predict the growth curve, that is how the weight changes with age, of any organism, in fact. And here's us, this is us, this is how we grow. It's a rat, happens to be us as a rat. The weight versus age. And what you see, those points are data points, and the line is a prediction. And I want to point out a couple of things here immediately. First, it explains why you grow quickly, and then you stop, and you spend much of your life in a relatively stable state. And that bounded growth is intimately related to the sublinear scaling of metabolic rate, the thing that's driving the system. The fact that you have an economy of scale, the bigger you get, the less energy is required for an individual gram of tissue or for an individual cell. That leads to this bounded growth, and indeed, one can take this structure and do it for any organism. Here's just a sampling of four, I guess. There are two mammals, a fish and a bird. And the thing I want to point out here is that this is a highly parsimonious theory. It's a universal theory. There are only two basic parameters in it, the average mass of a cell and the energy needed to create a cell. And those have universal characteristics. So it's the same for everybody, so you can predict the growth curves. And because of that universality, the theory tells you how to rescale age and weight so that everybody, if you look through the right lens, everybody is growing in the same way, despite the fact that a shrew may only be this size and live for a year or two, and a whale may be bigger than this auditorium and live for 150 years. And here's the picture. I'm not going to explain the axes, but they're rescaled mass on the vertical, rescaled age on the horizontal. And you can see it's pretty good. And that curve is determined by the theory. And you can see it's pretty well obeyed. And by the way, this can be extended to things like social insect communities, and it can be extended to tumors. So this is another avenue one can take this, is to understand the growth of tumors and start to think about affecting therapies based on that. Well, So I'm going to stop here about biology and use it as a point of departure for talking about social phenomena, cities in particular, and leading up to the question of sustainability. But first, I want to remind you that the few things that I've tried to emphasize. Despite their extraordinary complexity and diversity, life exhibits these amazing nonlinear scaling laws dominated by this quarter power. There's an economy of scale that's built into them that is due to the network. By the way, the economy of scale is intimately related to an idea, the following idea, that it needn't be this, but this is the way we think about it, is that the network is optimized. That is, the amount of energy that you need to pump blood through the system to support cells is optimized by the continuous process of natural selection in order to minimize it, in order to maximize the amount of energy that you can devote to sex and reproduction. So you minimize the amount of energy required for sustainability of the organism to maximize the Darwinian fitness. So that's the economy of scale. I didn't emphasize this either, but it was there. It was implicit and a little bit explicit. The pace of life systematically slows down the bigger you are. Things live longer. Life is stretched out, as you saw, in a systematic way. And growth, because of that, growth is sigmoidal, meaning things stop growing and reach a stable size of maturity. And we have a finite lifespan. We die. And all of this comes out of this picture. Okay. And it's all to do with the physics and mathematics of networks. So let's take these ideas as a point of departure and ask if we can apply it to things like cities. And if I have time, I'd like to talk a little bit about companies and ask, are they scaled? First of all, we have to ask the question. You know, the paradigm of this idea is, first of all, is there any scaling phenomena? Because if things scale like this, it indicates that underlying the dynamics, the complicated and complex dynamics, maybe there is some simplicity. So just as we saw that, despite appearances, a whale is actually a scaled-up elephant, which is a scaled-up giraffe, which is a scaled-up human being, which is a scaled-up mouse, and in this coarse-grained way, the question is New York a scaled-up Chicago, which is a scaled-up Santa Fe? Are we just a scaled-down New York City? Well, we don't look much like it. On the other hand, if you think about Santa Fe and you think about New York, almost everything about them has great similarities. We all have people in them. We all have roads. We all have shops. We all have a transportation system, and so on and so forth. And most importantly, we're all networks of one kind or another. We have transportation networks. We have resource networks, gas, electricity, water, etc. We have transportation networks, as I said, and we're supplied by networks. That's the physicality of the city, the infrastructure of the city, and as I intimated earlier, actually, it's the part we usually think of, but it's actually the least interesting part, because the most interesting part are the people in it who determine what the city is. And I want to talk about that a little bit. So that's represented by social networks, the interaction between people, and this is, I don't know if you can see it, the projection is not very good. Each node in that network is a person, and those lines are the people they interact with. So this is a typical social network diagram, and Santa Fe Institute is well known for developing many of the ideas, the modern ideas especially, about social networks and understanding network dynamics. One of the things that the image one has of this is somehow that networks are somehow virtual. They're sort of, you know, it's almost like they're in the cloud somewhere, the way we interact and so on, especially now with IT. But an essential feature of social networks, which is often forgotten, well, first one is not so often forgotten, is the one that this illustrates, first of all, is those rings around people, is that we're modular. We form modular groups. We have families, we have departments, we have groups, we have sections, and so on. We form modular groups. But even more important is what is illustrated here, is that we live on a two-dimensional surface. So even though we're interacting with each other, we have to be somewhere. So when you call someone on your cell phone, or you do Facebook or whatever, and you think of it sort of in the cloud, of course, each person has to be somewhere. They have to be in the kitchen, on a bus, on the toilet, wherever. They have to be somewhere connecting with someone, someplace, someone who is also somewhere. Place plays a critical role. We are bound to place. We're constrained by being somewhere. So we get to this idea that the social network cannot be completely independent of the spatial network, because not only do we have to be someplace, we also have to go someplace. You're here now, and maybe you're tweeting someone or, I don't know, sending a message to someone. You're here, but you're going to go home. You'll be going somewhere, which means you are bound by the network that is Santa Fe. So there is a... So what the city has accomplishes is an integration between the informational social network and the physical infrastructural network, and I'll come back to that shortly. So the question is, we are networks. We have much in common as cities, across different cities in the same urban system. Do we scale? Well, here's something pretty mundane. Number of gas stations plotted in the same logarithmic way, going up by factors of 10, of various cities in European countries against their size, using population to denote size. And what you see is there's very good evidence of scaling. It's the same kind of thing, a straight line on these simple graphs. And what you also see is that it's sublinear. I've actually drawn in here the dotted line that would indicate linear. Linear would mean double the size of a city, twice as many gas stations. No, double the size of a city, you need less than twice as many. And indeed, if you look at these just visually, you can see the slopes of these graphs are roughly speaking the same. And in fact, we've got data from all over the globe, from not just other, many other European cities, of course, the United States, but Latin American cities, China, Japan, and so on. And they all look just like this. They all look like this. They all have similar slopes, and the slope hovers always around 0.85. So the economy of scale here is 15% rather than the 25% that we saw in biology. So that's sort of interesting, and that's just petrol stations, or gas stations. I did it with some European colleagues. That's why it's called petrol. But what's amazing is if you look at any infrastructural quantity, the length of all the roads, the length of all the electrical lines, the water lines, whatever, whatever data we could get hold of, and you plot it, it looks just like this. So it doesn't matter what infrastructural quantity you look at, there's this 15% savings every time you double. And it's the same whether you look at it in the United States, France, Colombia, Chile, China, Japan, etc. So that's sort of amazing. It's sort of mimicking biology in terms of its universality, except it's a 15% rather than 25%. So that's just the infrastructure. Now to the interesting part, us. So this is two plots I'm showing you to begin with. On the left, you may not be able to read, is the wages versus population size for US cities. And you can see more scatter here, but you again see very good evidence of scaling. And on the right is something that a man named Richard Florida called super creative people, people like you, professional people, and plotted versus size of cities. And what you see, they both scale, and they scale with pretty much the same slope. And that slope is now very different than what you see in biology. It's the number hovers around 1.15. It's a 15% savings on the other side, a 15% enhancement on the other side, meaning that if you double the size of a city, wages go up. Wages don't just, the total wages, if you like, don't just double, they go up by 15%. So the wages per capita increase with city size. But it turns out, what is amazing is that any socioeconomic quantity that you look at behaves in exactly the same way, and it's the same way across the globe. And I'm just going to show you a couple of these. Here's patents. I'm sorry, I didn't put the number on here. This is just over 1.15. This is the number of patents produced. So the innovation of a city, if you like, a proxy for innovation. This is crime in Japan, a little bit bigger, 1.2. Police, taxes, construction, restaurants, and here I just put a little panel together of half a dozen, I hope you can see them, of different metrics. There's wages in the US, patents in the US, restaurants in Holland, professional people in the US, crime in Japan, and GDP of France. I could have shown many, many others. And you can just see by eye, they all have pretty much the same slope. They all have about this 15% savings. So, to put it into English, the good, bad, and the ugly all come together in terms of all derived from social interaction, in the sense that on average, when you double the size of a city, you systematically increase income, wealth, patents, all these various things, all the good stuff, but all the terrible stuff, AIDS and flu and crime and so on, all these all increase by the same, roughly speaking, 15%, regardless of the city, and at the same time, we save 15% on all infrastructure. So this leads one to speculate as to, of course, why, from this viewpoint, cities are so attractive. People are very good at suppressing the bad. They're very attracted to the positive, to the greater job opportunities, as I said earlier, the greater buzz and sexiness of a big city, and so on. And at the same time, collectively, we save 15% on all infrastructure. So cities are good, and big cities are even better. And indeed, a big city, because of this, produces, in that sense, less pollution, because the infrastructure is decreased. So the carbon footprint of New York City is significantly less per capita than Santa Fe. So if you want to be carbon friendly, you should all move to New York. And so, okay. So we have the same question. How is it that cities, the urban system of the United States and of Portugal and of China and Japan, et cetera, all scale in the same way? How could that be? What is it that has happened? It wasn't as if there was a famous Congress in 1723 where all the countries got together and said, this is how we're going to build our, you know, we can make individual changes, but this is how we're going to build our cities. No, it's in that sense a little bit like biology. It evolved organically. And the question is, what were the underlying drivers of that organic evolution? And the idea is, and it's sort of obvious, the idea is the commonality across all cities is that they are made of people, by people, and for people, and it is the reflection, a reflection, of the mathematics and physics of social interactions and of the social networks that is being manifested in these scaling laws, because people, in terms of their interactions and their social networks, are pretty much the same across the globe at the level of which we're talking. So, there's the idea. And one can put this into a mathematical framework, and I'm not, again, not going to belabor that. But I can already, as I said earlier, one of the hallmarks of science, and certainly of physics, is that you have a theory, you have models, you have fine regularities, you try to understand them, you try to generalize them, make theories, and then you make predictions, and then you see if either the data, new observation, or new experiment verifies that. So we can do that with this data, with this, because here is a plot of for the United States of income, GDP, crime, and patents. Very different things, all plotted on the same graph. They've been sort of renormalized, so they fit instead of, well, you understand. So it's plotted in that way, and you can see, that just illustrates, there's quite a bit of variance, as you can see, fluctuations, but you can see the general trend is very clear, and the slope of that is very close to this 1.15. Now, I said that the theory is that this all comes from social interactions, social networks. So we can make a prediction that if we could measure the connectivity between people as a function of their city size, it should follow this line. Okay. Well, that's extremely difficult. That tradition has been very difficult. Social scientists have tried to do it. They have done it by surveying people. You know, you send them out surveys or you talk to them on the street and so on. So traditionally it's been incredibly difficult and it's fraught with problems. Something miraculous happened. One of the unintended consequences of the IT revolution is that everybody in this auditorium carries a little detector with them, a little cell phone of some, almost always, I assume anyway. All of you carry a cell phone. And as I'm sure you know, the telephone company knows pretty much everything about you in terms of who you're talking to and where you are. So it records every call you make, where you are, to whom you talk to, and where they are, for example. So that is fantastic data, because if you can get hold of it, you can then use that as a proxy for social interaction. How many interactions are there? How does that change with the size of a city? And an interaction, by the way, in this is defined not just that you've made, I've called you, whoever you are, but within some period of time, say 6 months, you've called me back. So that establishes a relationship. So we assume something establishes, like that, establishes a relationship. And then one counts those as a function of city size and then plots that versus the size of the city. And that's what is done on the right. And what you can see, it's done for two countries. By the way, I should say, this work was done in collaboration with a marvelous group of people at MIT who had access to these huge data, these billions and billions of phone calls. So this is one of the results that came out of it, was that you can see that the slope of this for these two countries, one is United Kingdom, the other is Portugal, are quite similar to the slope of this universal graph, and strongly suggesting that indeed the origin of this is to do with the underlying fundamental dynamics of human interaction that we've evolved with since becoming sedentary city dwellers. I'm going to skip the next bit because I wanted to show you, you can do a great deal with this cell phone data, obviously, because it's as if, by the way, every molecule in this room is being tagged in terms of, you know, where it's moving, how fast it's moving, who it's bumped into, and so on. So it's kind of amazing. Not very useful for physics, but unbelievably useful for understanding social interaction. So the next bit I'm going to miss, which is movement in cities, how you can do this about movement, and I'm skipping, just don't look at that. So I want to do two or three other things before finishing up. First is, I said earlier that in biology, the bigger you are, the slower everything is, according to these quarter power scaling laws. Hearts beat slower, life goes on longer, et cetera, in a systematic, predictable way on the average. It turns out the nature of social networks produces the opposite behavior. And you're all familiar with the nature of social networks. I talked to, who's done it? Penelope, I recognize. I talked to Penny, she talks to the lady next to her, she talks to, Monica, I recognize you too, this is all my friends. And then you talk to me and we have this conversation and ideas develop. I said that earlier, but a central feature of this process is that it has positive feedback in it. We go back and forth and so on, and ideas. Most of the ideas, as I said, are trivial. Some are profound, and they produce quantum mechanics and iPhones and so on, but some remain trivial, but doesn't matter. They produce, there's this positive feedback which is continually increasing the pace of life, and I will get to that. So that's what I've written down here, and indeed, it is the origin, that positive feedback is indeed the origin of, I didn't use the word, it was written there, superlinear behavior, bigger than one behavior for the slopes of those socioeconomic quantities, has its origin in that positive feedback nature of social interactions. It's also coupled, by the way, to the modularity, but it is positive feedback plays an important role. But another consequence is, instead of slowing life down, it speeds up. So on the left, we saw that graph before. Heart rates decrease systematically. On the right, we have a socioeconomic quantity. This is a bit of a stretch. Is walking speed. We've looked at many other things, but this is kind of cute, that walking speed in cities increases systematically according to this. This is basically the prediction of the theory. And you can see there's a lot of scatter, but this is a bunch of, this is data that was taken a long time ago. But you're very familiar with this phenomenon. And I just did want to show you this picture, which I saw in a British newspaper about a year ago. And I'll read you the caption because you probably can't read it. It's a picture taken in the city of Liverpool. And it says underneath, research revealed almost half of the nation, meaning the United Kingdom, found the slow pace of high streets to be their biggest shopping bugbear. Not the bloody cars and the noise and the pollution and all the other rubbish that people talk about. It's the other people getting in the way, not walking fast enough for the size of the city. So what did Liverpool do? They introduced a fast lane for walking. And this is the first day. So, I now want to take that idea and talk about growth very quickly. It's the same idea as for biological growth. What comes in, so to speak, the social metabolism. Everything that comes into the system, into the city. Both energy and resources, but money and so on, and everything that comes in that is driving the city is going into, on the one hand, maintenance. You repair the roads and the buildings, you repair people, you have hospitals and so on. There's repair mechanism, and then there's growth. You grow new buildings and roads, and you grow new people. So there's, you can write this down, put this into mathematics, and amazingly, you can solve the equation, and I'm going to show you that. This is when you solve it if the metabolism, the thing that's driving it, is sublinear. We saw that. That was this. The stopping of growth. Sublinear stops. If it's superlinear, positive feedback, things getting faster, this is what happens on the left. Only look at the left for the moment. What is plotted here is any socioeconomic quantity we've talked about versus time. And you can see, zoom, just what we've experienced, just what I showed. And indeed, I'm not going to waste your time showing you lots of data of various cities and of the world and so on, but so this is a very nice framework because the theory predicts not just the superlinear scaling, but as a result of that, it predicts that we get around this stopping of growth and we can continue in the paradigm to which we have grown alarmingly accustomed, that we have to have continuous open-ended growth. Fantastic, marvelous, except there's a fatal flaw. And the fatal flaw is denoted by that dotted line with a little T subscript C on it, which is something that we call a finite time singularity, which is a part of, comes in the mathematical equation. And all that means is, what is indicated here, something absurd, whatever the quantity that you're plotting here, becomes infinite in a finite time. That means that in some finite time in the future, it might be 5 years, 10 years, 100 years, 200 years, but sometime in the future, one of these quantities, the GDP, the number of AIDS cases, the wages, are going to become infinite. Obviously, completely crazy. But the theory tells you what happens if you start going along that route, the system collapses. And that's on the right. The system stagnates and collapses. Well, this is a fancy schmancy version of the old Malthusian argument that you can't keep up, production can't keep up with expansion, the growth of the expansion of the population. And indeed, Malthus, and then some of you may be familiar with the Club of Rome and Paul Ehrlich's population explosion, were all viciously attacked, rightly so, because they were wrong, and that we don't collapse, and we haven't collapsed. And the reason we do not collapse is because this same social interaction gives rise to innovation. And innovation intervenes so that, as you're going along this curve, in some paradigmatic innovative state, you've discovered coal, or maybe don't know, 10,000 years or whatever it was ago, one discovered iron or bronze, or more recently we invented computers or IT, but something profound in terms of its innovative power is bit, that's how that system grew, but you have to reset the clock by making a major change, a major innovation to avoid the collapse. So somewhere along there, before you reach this finite time singularity, you better make a major innovation, reset the clock, reinvent yourself, so to speak, and start over again. And so it goes. And so you would go on, marvelous, that's what we've done. And of course, you would hit another finite time singularity, so you better do it again, and again, and so forth. So there's a sort of theorem that you can prove that if you demand, as we have, that we have open-ended growth, we better have continuous cycles of innovation. Well, people have talked about this for a long time, that we need to do that, and we have done that, and that's why we chuck out Malthus and Paul Ehrlich and the Club of Rome and the rest of them. So that's great, that's what we've done, but there's another catch, and that's the following. When you go along any one of these curves, as you're going up, life gets faster, as I said. But even more so, the time between innovations has to get shorter. So it's not only that your life is accelerating, but you have to accelerate innovation. So, I don't know, if it took 100 years to develop something 1,000 years ago, now it only takes 20 years. So, there is, and I will show you, so I will show you a little bit of data. This is not mine, and I don't even know who this guy is, actually. But he did something cute. He plotted, as a measure of innovation, these are not major innovations, maybe, but this by the way, this whole structure can apply at any level, the global level, city level, individual level, even. What you see is time to reach 10 million customers, an interesting metric. And you can see, I didn't know this, he drew it sort of the way I had drawn it. And indeed, if you take these numbers and you plot them, they follow exactly the prediction of this theory. And this one is another way of looking at it, done by someone that's made a lot of money out of talking about singularities, Ray Kurzweil, and this is his data, not mine. And what is plotted here, I don't particularly like it, but it illustrates the point. What is plotted is how long it take on the vertical axis, how long did it take to make cells, life? It took, you see, 10 to the 9th, a billion years, and it happened, look along the horizontal axis, a billion years ago, roughly, several billion years ago, and so on. And you can look it down this, and what you see, the internet took place 10 years ago and only took 10 years or 20 years to develop. So there it is, plotted in this logarithmic way. And why I like this is the theory I just told you about this continuous thing, if you ask where do those points sit, they follow exactly that line. So there is data to support the idea. And the big question is, obviously, let's go back. Whoops. Can this be sustained? That is it conceivable, if you take this to its sort of logical conclusion, and it's speculative, of course, that we're going to have an innovation as big as the IT one in maybe 20 years. And then we're going to have one as big as that in maybe 18 years. And then 15 years, another one later. And eventually we're going to have to do it every year. Well, obviously, if it's sort of reductio absurdum, it just isn't possible. And it's as if we're on this accelerating treadmill, jumping from one treadmill to another, but jumping at an accelerated rate onto accelerating treadmills. And the question is, can we do it socioeconomically without having a socioeconomic heart attack? And I think I might have to stop here. I was going to talk a little bit about companies and how companies feed into it, but I think I'll stop here and just skip through. You just not have to look at these slides. Actually, this slide is interesting because this is the number, this is just the side, this is tangential, but it's sort of interesting. It'll amaze you. It amazed me, anyway. This is the number of firms as a function of city size, and it's linear. It's one of the few linear, well, like households. You double the size of a city, you double the number of households. Double the size of a city, you double the number of firms. But what's interesting about that is the parameters. It turns out the slope of this means that every time you add 20 people, on the average, if you average over a long enough time, you add a company. Or, so that's sort of amazing, each firm only is equivalent to 20, only 20 people, or the number of employees associated with each added firm is about 12. Sort of amazing, on the average. I mean, obviously some have one or two and some have hundreds, but on the average. Well, I'm not going to talk about diversity, and I'm not going to talk about the death of companies. I'm sorry, I missed this. And why companies die, and so on, and why they have to die. But I'm going to finish up with just two things, extremely quickly. I didn't emphasize when I showed the graph of metabolic rate, if you looked, and many of you maybe it did, and maybe you know this, if you look on that graph and you see where you as a human being sat on that graph of metabolic rate, you look across, that number is a little less than 100 watts. So you are operating in terms of that, the 2,000 food calories a day is just under 100 watts. A light bulb, that's all you use to stay alive. Each one of us sitting here is 100 watts. You're alive. We are unbelievably efficient. Life is extraordinarily efficient relative to the synthetic life, so to speak, that we built around us, which is represented by the second thing I've written up there, and that is something I call social metabolic rate, and I referred to it slightly earlier, and that is if you add up all the energy you need to stay in this socioeconomic state that we are in the United States. Meaning, you have to have these lights, you have to have a warm building or air conditioning, you have to have an automobile, you have to have streets, you have to have a home, you have to have a refrigerator, et cetera, et cetera. If you add up all of that energy that each person in this room requires, instead of just 100 watts, which is what we evolve with and we're operating at, well, if you add in running and hunting, it might have been 200 or 300 watts, but instead of the 200 or 300 watts, you now need 11,000 watts. And you can turn this around and ask yourself, how big an animal is each person in this room effectively acting as? And here's the answer. You're a King Kong. You're bigger than King Kong, actually. 30,000 kilograms. You're about 70% of a blue whale, each person. Or you're the equivalent to a dozen elephants. And there are 7.5 billion people on the planet, and each one wants to be like us in their own way. They all want to operate at 11,000 watts and have all the things we have. And in a short period of time, there will be 3 billion more coming on board. And they all want to operate at this rate. So we have an awesome problem to deal with. I haven't provided answers here. I will suggest one, because it might come up in a question, to get out of this terrible bind that we're in, of this treadmill of having to go faster and faster. You notice that when we think of paradigm shifts and we think of growth, typically, socioeconomically, we think in very material terms. We think of paradigms shift means technological innovation. Coal, iron, computers, IT, whatever. And growth we think of in terms of dollars, GDP, or the Dow Jones average, or something of that nature. So if we remain with that, one speculates that this is simply not sustainable, and the system will eventually collapse, whether we like it or not. However, maybe we should think of a different paradigm shift, as grand as this, as one of these, and that is a kind of cultural paradigm shift. This is totally speculative thinking, but that we need to change the way we think of our social interactions, because you remember all of this, if you believe any of it, is derived from the dynamics of social interactions. So we need to somehow change the nature of social interactions, the nature of the way our society is structured, and the way we think of growth. And I've become very Santa Fe here, and I'm certainly, this is not original with me, but it would be wonderful on the news each night, not just that they just don't say the Dow Jones average is whatever it is, and it went up 2 points, but they said yesterday, the quality of life index in the United States dropped 5 points because of Houston, or it went up 10 points because of, I don't know what, Burning Man, I don't know, something happened. But wouldn't it be wonderful if we had a difference? So we need somehow, I don't need free cars and a great big fucking house with only two of us. But I do, and I want it. So this is the issue. Now, I do want to finish. I've been talking too long, but I do want to show all the people that did a major part of this work, maybe all of this work in some ways. These are this wonderful group of people whom I love. Jim Brown, I started with and got me involved with the Santa Fe Institute, is a very well-known biologist, ecologist, who had just moved to the University of New Mexico when I interacted with him. And the first work was done with him and his then student, Brian, who himself has become an established ecologist. And these are all wonderful people. They're all young and good-looking and happy. These aren't quite as happy, but they're also wonderful, and I love them. And by the way, all of these people were associated in one way or another with the Santa Fe Institute and have either came or moved on. Some were students and postdocs have got excellent faculty positions in various places. This is when I moved into the city work and a new collaboration put together. And again, a marvelous bunch of people. It was started actually at the Center for Institute with these distinguished people at the bottom, including Dirk, actually, who did almost none of the work. All of the work was done by the people, the top people there. And I couldn't resist as I was going through things. I know this is kind of indulgent, but here's a picture from Jim Brown's 70th birthday. And you can see how happy everybody is, because it was such a wonderful collaboration. And by the way, I hate to admit it, but it's 5 years ago and I'm wearing the same shirt and pants. Thank you. Oh, and I should show you, these are the people that supported this work. Most of it, interestingly enough, came from private funding. And I don't want to get into that, but it did. The National Science Foundation was extraordinary in its early funding of this, and highly stimulative, but the bulk of the funding eventually came from private sources. So I'll finish there, and I'm sorry, I can look at the clock now, and I've gone way too long, and I apologize. So thank you very much. Do I have any questions? I'm told I should have a question. Is it too late? Oh, so I'm happy to answer questions or criticisms, comments.
Okay, I have a question here.
I can't hear.
Can you hear me?
No.
Can you hear me now? I guess you can. I'm going to ask you about something that, of course, is being talked about a lot, and that's electrical power generation and energy, and I'm surprised you didn't talk about it. When I saw your graph of mammals with the amount of power, which is not energy, plotted in watts versus size, I wondered if you've looked at the amount of watts that we need, so to speak, at per capita by various countries. As you probably know, we need a lot more than Kenya, for example, or any other places. But have you plotted up or looked at those to see if you get log linear plot or power function relationship? And does that relate to population, age or birth rate, or just how does that linearity and the log work out?
The short answer is yes. I have. We have. All of the above. I chose not to show it. That is looking at that 11,000 watts, which is us, as a function of different countries and different size of countries and all kinds of other metrics. There is a sort of systematic behavior. And one of the interesting things, you can see all kinds of interesting outliers, which I do not want to go into here. Maybe one of the most interesting things that we looked at in parallel with that I actually originally had a slide of this in the talk, and then it was just getting way too long. And that is fecundity versus metabolic rate, social metabolic rate. So fecundity is, you know, the number of children you produce. And if you plot animal, you know, fecundity, number of offspring, scales also following a kind of quarter power scaling law, because it's intimately related to the use of metabolic energy to reproduce, and it does. And as biological human beings, before we became social, when we presumably had, I don't know what the number is, a dozen children, 15 offspring, of which, you know, a third died, etc., we fit pretty well on the graph that we should. That is that, you know, we had the right number of children. Now we have, you know, barely one or two, many of us in the developed world. And so what is interesting is if you plot us, if you plot human societies versus just what you said, their social metabolic rate, how much energy they use, then they follow the same curve as the same line as the biological line, but now interpreting social metabolic rate as metabolic rate. So I don't really understand why that should be quite the way it is, frankly, but if you just naively follow it through, you can not only, in fact, it was originally predicted. We originally predicted it and then got the data and found that it was true and were quite surprised, but it was predicted with a very, you know, just speculating that it would just follow the same biological form. So yeah, there's all kinds of things you can do like that, but I chose not to put them in here. As I say, I said at the beginning, there are many loose ends here, many of which we have not examined, some of which we have, which are not in here.
In your opinion, in regard to scale, insofar as climate change and global warming, have we reached the tipping point or have we already passed the point of no return?
Well, I'm not an expert on global warming and climate change at all. I certainly have talked to lots of people, heard lots of talks, and I've been to talked at conferences when it's devoted to it, but I'm not an expert. I would say it depends what you mean by a tipping point. I think the answer is, as you no doubt know, you know, it's clear the temperature has risen, and I think it's also pretty clear it's generated by what we've done on the planet. And by the way, that's why I showed in a very naive way that night lights, because you get a real feeling for the bloody thing is burning, it's getting hotter. You know, I mean, it's a slightly naive way of looking at it. But in reality, that is the origin of global warming, of course. And that's going on. And the question is, you know, can we control it to levels at which we don't overly pollute the atmosphere destroy, you know, the environment that keeps us, that sustains us? I don't know the answer to that. I don't think anyone does, frankly. I mean, there's all kinds of scenarios. One of the pieces of work that we have done along those lines was one of the other things I did not talk about here is extending this to ecosystems, to forests. You know, thinking of the forest as a collection of trees and seeing the forest as a collection and asking about its properties in the same way one does about a city or an organism. And that's actually quite powerful because the model is developed without any resource constraint. But you can now put in things like resource constraint. You can put in pardon me, the questions of the environment, like the ambient temperature, because the temperature, I didn't show this, controls also is a major constraint on metabolic rate. The higher the temperature, the higher the metabolic rate, because the higher the temperature, the faster, exponentially faster, our chemical reactions. So greater heat is produced. So what one can do with this, and what we have done, is take this model, this theory of forests in a kind of basal state, and perturb it with increasing the temperature by 1 degree, 2 degrees, and 3 degrees, and see what happens to the various characteristics of the forest. And I'm not going to go into that here, but one can start looking at that, but it needs many more serious studies like that before we can really conclude what the effects will be and when the effect will take place. I was here much more concerned about something which generated the global warming, and that is the system itself which generated it, and whether that is in principle sustainable. So I took it to another level, of which global warming or climate change is one piece. And I take a what I suspect is a small minority view that dealing only and thinking only of global warming and climate change without coupling it to all the other systems that I talked about here could be misleading, because they are complex adaptive systems continually interacting.
I'm going to have to admit to being a Club of Rome survivor.
You're going to be what?
I'm a Club of Rome survivor.
Ah, love you.
So I worked with Dennis Meadows at Dartmouth when he left MIT and Jay Forrester. So
yeah.
I was a graduate student there. Ah. So I've been in the trenches with this stuff.
Fantastic.
But something I've thought about ever since then, do you think that information is not subject to the law of entropy?
Well, first, I'm delighted that you work with the Club of Rome, and I know Dennis Meadows not very well, but beginning 3, 4, 5 years ago, the Club of Rome still exists, as you well know, and I was approached by people in the Club of Rome. I happen to actually be a friend of the son of Aurelio Peche, who started it. But independent of that, both him and someone else at UCLA approached me about reviving that whole thing, you know, but doing it now in a way, yeah, exactly. And I was a bit reluctant, but we did try, but in fact we tried to get funding, and we couldn't get funding to have a kind of simulator of all of that, a la Club of Rome. Anyway, that's another story. But so it's interesting that you brought that up. Information. Well, information is crucial, and one of the things that's missing in most of the traditional arguments, but even modern arguments, is the role of information exchange and social interaction. And the laws of, you know, there are, of course, laws and constraints on information. Translating that, I think the hard thing about that is translating whatever the formal structure is of information theory into the things that we can measure, and the kinds of things I was talking about here. And that's extremely hard. And one of the other challenges associated with that, which this, as I just scratches the surface, is that in trying to understand not just cities, but any socioeconomic entity, is the fact that the infrastructural part, the physical part, and the informational social part are highly interconnected necessarily. And by the way, I didn't say this when I did this. So in the theoretical development, one of the things that one can derive is that when you try to do this, when you try to bring the information in sync with the infrastructure, in the way I said, the fact that when you interact with someone, you're here and you have to get over there eventually. You have to put that into some mathematical framework. One of the things that you can show is that the 15% savings on infrastructure is actually the same 15% added, value added on socioeconomic quantities. It's not an accident that those are both 15%. They are, in terms of the coarse-grained generic structure of the theory, interrelated to one another.
So does that mean it's defeated entropy?
No, 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 no. Was that there? Oh, I thought someone was talking.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm going to tie some things together. Heaven help me. Okay, first thing. The context in which this whole thing is occurring is a particular paradigm, a way of operating, which is conceptual understanding. It's using the word mind, whether that's mathematical expressions or language, it's still conceptual. I like the raising of the question about information entropy. Everybody experiences it in the form of information overload, such as you get a new smartphone and how does it work? Every technological advance involves a complete rehash of the conceptual structure, right? So you had an increasingly rapid development of, I'll call it civilization structures. It's not just technology, but the conceptual structure. And I am. I have to set the stage first. Okay. So what that accelerating process of innovation points to is that people are going to be increasingly overloaded if they use the conceptual structure as their frame of reference. They use the conceptual mind as a frame of reference. And what that seems to suggest to me is that our evolutionary leap will be beyond the use of the conceptual mind to something more fundamental, probably just greater integrity and intuition that uses the conceptual mind, rather than relying upon it for its answers. That was my comment.
Oh, okay, fine. Anyone else? Anything else? There's one here. Just yell it out. Do we who finishes this?
Oh, I'll be the last question.
Last one, she says. Good.
Thank you.
I mean, not good.
You mentioned that that as more people would gather together, more ideas would be exchanged among smaller groups, less ideas, more groups, more ideas. Do you, maybe this is a difficult thing to measure, but do you see the ratio between the profound ideas and less profound ideas remaining the same in that exchange? Or with the growth of social media, do we see a lower degree of profound ideas, or how does it change?
I don't think that's an answerable question, for one thing. I don't even know how to address it, really. About I don't know how you would measure that, so I just have to pass on that. I can't answer. I don't know what the answer is. An unfortunate place to stop, but we should maybe stop there. Thank you.